Okay. Please.
Okay, thanks. So last week you followed the lecture by Fabio Cecconi, and so now you have already an introduction of the main aspect of a dynamical system. And now the second part I discuss about the statistical description of a dynamical system. So, apparently sound an oxymoron to use a statistical approach in a deterministic system, but you already know that there exists deterministic chaos, no? Butterfly effect in pop culture. And so what means? And the fact that this deterministic system is can be chaotic, this is implies the necessity to use a statistical approach. Why? Because in deterministic system you have the following structure. You have a certain initial condition, and the deterministic means that from the initial condition you have a certain the states at time t, which I write in a formal way in this way. Okay, where this is the evolution of the system, and this is unique. It's from the same initial condition follow always the same stuff. So, why is it necessary to introduce a statistical description? So you know that if you have a certain uncertainty on the initial state in the chaotic system, you have that the uncertainty increase in time exponentially. Okay, then I discuss in more formal way. So what is important this quantity here is called the Lyapunov exponent. I'll be more precise in the following, but what is important that at least for a certain time you have roughly an exponential growth. So the fact that this exponential growth of the uncertainty means that you have a predictability time. So the periodic time is the maximum. Sorry. Imagine that you have a certain initial mistake, uncertainty. Imagine you perform a measurement with your instrument, and depending on your budget, you can reach a certain delta zero. If you obtain a big grant, you can decrease this. Okay. So you have this is the uncertainty of the initial condition. And then you have a certain tolerance. So you accept tolerance. Okay. You can decide that you have accept tolerance of 10%. Okay? And you wonder what is the maximum time such that the mistake is below this threshold. So you just use this equation here. You put here delta, this delta zero. And this is the predictability time. So you have that the predictability time is 1 over lambda, and it's log of delta, capital delta. Okay, you have this. Okay. So and after this time, your precision is not good enough. Okay. So for example, in the Lorentz model, you discuss the Lorentz model with Fabio Cecconi. You have something like that, this increase. And then this saturate, okay? So imagine that you fix here delta, you have delta zero. Okay. This is the predictability time, okay? What is important is order of the magnitude, not important factor two, who cares? Well, from this trivial formula, you see that there is a part here where you see that the predictability time depends on your tolerance and how rich you are, no? Because you can decrease this number if you start from here. It change a bit, okay? But what is really important is this slope. Huh? This slope is given by the the Lyapunov exponent. So you see, this is the inverse of the Lyapunov exponent is a characteristic time. Okay, so this means you have a certain characteristic time, and then there is some log. Okay, but this is what is important. So, but this can be 2, 3, 5, cannot be 200. So, what is really important is number. Okay, for example, in the atmospheric system, this time is something like 1 week. Okay, why in astronomical problem this time can be million years. And this is the difference of the weather and the. So, and then you can wonder what I can do if I go at a larger time, at time larger, or maybe much larger than this predictability time. This predictability time. What I can do? So at practical level, you are not able to follow the system, but at the conceptual, say using a pompous term, at ontological level, your system is deterministic. So apparently there is a contradiction. It's clear that you are not able to follow your system with the due precision. And so you are forced to change the point of view. The point of view, you have to change your point of view. This is the point of view in the deterministic point of view, differential equation and so on. The practical approach is the following, to consider not only this, but also this stuff. Okay, so this means, If this is different from zero, this means that you have a probability distribution at initial time. Okay, so you can imagine that, for example, this is the point, this is x zero, and you have a certain uncertainty in this ball. You have zero in this region. So and the constant and is one over the volume of this volume, huh? The volume given by delta zero. Okay, for example, something like that. Okay, you have this situation, and then at the practical level, the question is to look at the evolution of this probability distribution. And to try to understand the evolution of the probability distribution, how behave this stuff. So you see that it's true that you have a deterministic system, but you have some problem on the initial condition. And so an honest way at the practical level to reformulate the problem is the following. You have this evolution rule, but you can wonder what is the evolution rule for this. And then you wonder, and you can wonder about the typical problem you have in a statistical situation. Okay, as far as I know, the man who introduced this idea was Maxwell. Maxwell in a famous lecture in the Apostle Club wondered about the idea from the same antecedent follow the same situation is a metaphysical idea. It's a metaphysical because it's impossible to repeat exactly the experiment twice in the same way. So if you, apart at the metaphysical level, the idea of Maxwell, this is a unique practical approach. Okay, and then you have to reformulate this in mathematical term, of course. Okay, so then this idea of the use of statistical approach in deterministic system, there are, in some sense, two possible origins. One is this one, due to chaos. Of course, Maxwell didn't know chaos, but in our language, but he know the idea, he know very well that result instability and so on. Another approach is due to Boltzmann. But in that case, the use of the probability due to the fact that the number of degree of freedom is very large. But there are some connections between these two points of view. Okay, I don't know how you are familiar with the ergodic hypothesis of statistical mechanics. You are familiar? Let me just briefly mention just. And the fact that the problem in statistical mechanics, the idea is introduced because of the problem is huge, it's very large, and so on. But at the mathematical level, you can reformulate the problem in any system. There is no difference. But let me repeat briefly the idea of Boltzmann. And so this is really useful just to fix the dictionary. So in the sense of Boltzmann, you have an Hamiltonian system. Where Q is some R to something, okay? And P is the same. Okay, so you have the Hamilton equation. Oh, let me call X the point in the phase, the representing point in the phase space. You have the Hamiltonian equation. So in the Hamiltonian equation, you have an evolution rule. So you have this, at least at the formal way, in the sense that nobody is able to solve Hamilton equation in generic situation, but don't worry. What is important? So you have an evolution. Then you know that in Hamilton, there is the Liouville theorem. You have the Liouville theorem. So that from the fact that you have the Liouville theorem, you know that one possible measure is the microcanonical measure. No? Microcanonical measure is this one. No? Okay. And you know that the microcanonical measure is invariant under time evolution, in the sense that if I take a region A and I on a certain region, and then this is the region, then I take the evolution of this region, this let me call STA, and I look at the probability to stay here, the probability to stay here is the same, okay? And so on, okay? So here, what is the ingredient of the problem? Using mathematical terminology, the ingredient, here you have that the system lives on the region, let me call omega. Omega are the x such that h of x is equal to energy. Okay, so the structure of the mathematical term. Of course, this is not the language of Boltzmann, right? This is the language of the mathematician Birkhoff, Neumann. So the language is, you have a phase space where the system lives. Then you have an evolution. This is the phase space. This you have an evolution. And then you have the invariant measure, okay? So here the invariant measure is nothing but the integral on the region of the level. Okay, invariant measure means that I have this property. Oh, the mathematician prefer to write in this way because usually the evolution is not invertible. So this means that these are the points such that you evolve after time t, you arrive here, okay? The pre-images. Okay, so you have this situation. Okay, this is the prototype. So if you take a mathematical book on dynamical system, they start with this triad. So the the phase space, the evolution, and the measure. Okay. In this case, the meaning is this is nothing but the hypersurface energy, constant energy. This is the Hamiltonian equation, and this is the microorganism distribution. Okay. And then, so you see here in this, you have a mixture of the determinism here, yeah, and probability. Okay. And then the ergodic hypothesis is the following, that when you perform, you can wonder, so you know that from the elementary course on statistical mechanics that you have a microcanonical, undercanonical, grand canonical, and so on. And from this, you perform some average or some quantity, okay? And then you can wonder, but okay, I have some observable, and from this observable, I compute an average, for example, microcanonical. Okay, this is a nice exercise, but then you can wonder what is the relation of this quantity with the real world? We are physicists. And so even in the theoretical field, you have to consider the problem, what is the physical relevance of your computation? How this stuff is related to the real world, okay? The connection, at least according to a certain way to consider statistical mechanics, is in terms of the ergodic hypothesis. Boltzmann. I don't remember more or less. Let me reformulate in modern term. Okay, in modern term, the hypothesis is the following: you have an observable, and you have an instrument, and when you measure something, for example, you measure the pressure. You measure pressure with the manometer. There appear on the display a certain number. How this number is obtained from the instrument? So the instrument perform a time average. No, in the case of the manometer, measure the transfer of impulse on a small region. So your time evolution of you start from a point X, the system evolve, and the instrument perform an average on a certain region from zero to T, and then divide by T. Okay, this is the time average, okay, which is performed by the instrument, and this is what this is the real fact in what the physicists measure on the table in experiment. And of course, if you do this, you realize that this is practically impossible to do analytically this computation. Why? Because you need the knowledge of the initial state. This is the first problem. How to measure the phase space is enormous. So okay. Then you have to find the solution of the equation, which is billions of billions of Avogadro number. This is the second difficulty. The third difficulty is that you perform the integral. Okay, each of these points are practically impossible. Okay, this is the real stuff, but immediately you realize that it's impossible. Okay, but this is what you want. Okay. So the remark of Boltzmann is the following. So if this quantity in principle is a function of X, which is the initial time, let me write X zero just to remind the initial condition and the duration of the measurement. Okay. In principle, okay. Actually, this depends on these two stuff. So if this is the case, if it really depends on initial condition, it's a disaster is a disaster because nobody is able to understand the initial condition. And so you want to, so you hope that at least if t is large enough, this is not, doesn't depend on t, okay? So you have a long integral. Okay, this is the first problem. And then the second problem, if there is a dependence on x0, okay? And what you hope, that the hope that t, when t go to zero, this is the average with the invariant probability, okay? This is the hope, and this hope is the ergodic hypothesis. The ergodic hypothesis is that the real stuff, the real quantity is the time average. But nobody is able to compute. On the contrary, the average with the canonical ensemble are relatively simple. And if this is true, we are happy and we solve the problem. The question is this is true? Okay, this is the okay. Then this has been for Hamiltonian system. But can you repeat all the problem for any dynamical system? You can repeat this problem in any dynamical system in which you have a phase space, an evolution, and invariant mesh. No, this is a sort of problem in the measure theory. The problem started in physics, but then can be generalized. Okay, and then you have the problem. And so now many years ago. And now the mathematician arrive and they say to fix to put order in the question. And there are two important results around 1930 due to Birkhoff. F. Neumann. The theorem one is very important from a mathematical point of view, but from a physical point of view is with due respect of these two giants, completely irrelevant. Okay, the theorem one is okay, under set hypothesis, blah blah blah, you can imagine. The limit 1 over t integral this stuff exists. So it means that this quantity, so this the limit of t go to infinite so f x 0 t is a certain quantity, like g of x 0. This is clear. So the limit that exists is not surprising for us. It's not surprising. This is what you expect. But remain the problem of dependence of x zero. Okay. So the first theorem solves the problem for t go to infinity. The limit that exists. But if it is true or not, it's not obvious. The second theorem is about the tough point. Okay, this is okay. Okay, there exists the limit. The second point is about the dependence of x zero, and this is a tough point, and this is called ergodic theorem. But it's not the solution of the ergodic hypothesis. The ergodic hypothesis is still there. Okay, the second theorem. The following: there is a necessary and sufficient condition for the ergodicity. I mention now, but in some sense, it's just a shift of the problem. So a problem: the system is ergodic if something happens, but then you have to prove that this happened, and this is not easy. Okay, okay. Discuss the proof of the theorem. The second theorem is that is ergodic. If and only if it is impossible to find, we call B in omega, B in omega, such that the evolution of B is B. So this is omega, this is B, and if I start from B, I remain in B. Invariant. So this B is invariant under evolution. Okay. So if I consider the evolution of B, it's still B. Okay. Such that the measure of B must be different from 1 or 0. Okay. Of course, if I take B, all the system is okay. If I take B, a point is not true. Okay. So this means that if it is impossible to divide the system in two parts, and each of these parts is invariant and are non-trivial, this means that these are non-trivial, then the system is ergodic. So you see that practically you shift the problem to this. So this theorem can be useful to prove that the system is not ergodic, because immediately you realize immediately, for example, if there exists in a direction the proof is trivial. No? Imagine that there exists a situation like that. In this case, it's for surely the system is not ergodic. Why? Because I consider an observable, which is one if X is in B and zero if it's not in B. Okay, then I consider X zero in B. Of course, XT will be in B, and so A of XT is always one. Okay, then I perform the average. Oh, sorry, let me. This average usually just the average respect to time usually introduced with an over bar. The time average is for sure is one if you start from here. But if you start from a point which is not B, you have zero. So you see the time average depends where you start. So if you start from here, you obtain one, you start from here, you obtain zero. And that's it. So this, okay, this is a proof of the theorem in this direction. If you are able to find a partition such that, then the system for sure is not ergodic. Okay, and this is the end of the story. In the other direction, the proof is non-trivial. But this theorem are very important. But however, this just shifts the problem to understand if the system is ergodic or not. Okay, so the problem to understand if the system is ergodic or not is non-trivial. It absolutely is non-trivial. What is the connection? The ergodic hypothesis, in some sense, the fact that the system is ergodic is you are assuming that ergodic hypothesis corresponds to assume the validity of the law of a large number in a non-trivial situation. Let me discuss this point. So ergodicity, which sounds a very exotic argument, is not exotic at all, because it's the extension in the deterministic situation of the law of large number. No, so you know the law of large number, no? So I consider the case continuous time. You can use also discrete time, is the same, it's not important. In the case of discrete time, instead of integral, you have the sum. Okay, so you know that the law of the large number, you remember you have x1, xt, where these are independent, identical, distributed variable with finite variance. Remember that if you consider sum of x, t go to 1 to t, 1 over t, this tend in some sense to the average of x, this is integral of x. Okay, you remember this in a more formal way. Okay. So now you assume that this is in elementary statistical, in elementary probability theory. Now imagine that you have a dynamical system xt plus 1 equal a certain f xt. Okay, so this is a dynamical system, and maybe you have an invariant probability distribution, which is non-trivial. Another point, in the mathematician start assuming the invariant probability distribution, but at the physical level, the invariant probability distribution is already a non-trivial problem. Okay, so but imagine that you solve the invariant, you already know the invariant probability distribution that we call rho. The mathematician speak about measure, the physicist speak of density. Of course, the mathematician right, and we are a bit rough, because in general you say that the invariant, the measure, you. Typically, we physicists write this. But this is not as precise, because in general, it's not true. In general, doesn't exist a rho, which is an acceptable factor. But for the moment, let assume that this is possible, okay? Then I show you that in general, it's not true, but a problem, not all the problem together. So imagine so this is the evolution law, then you have this rho, then how to determine rho is another problem. And then you can wonder if I start from x0 and then I obtain x1 just this way, and so on, x2 and so on. And then I consider the limit t go to infinite, 1 over t sum of xt. This is equal to this. This is the ergodic problem. The ergodic problem in a map. The ergodic problem in a map. Okay. And so, but here you have also the trouble that you don't know this stuff. Okay. So we have to reconsider the problem from the very beginning. Okay. But just now, assuming a very empirical approach. Just you have a computer, you can play with in a simple way. For example, I know that you are very busy, but if you have time, just an exercise, an homework. For example, let us consider this stuff. Let us consider this stuff. Exercise, take this stuff. Take this. Then consider x0, a certain x0, I don't know, point, a number between 0 and 1. A number between 0 and 1. And then from this you obtain, you fall, you have this stuff. And then you compute, you can compute x, this limit equal to infinite 1 over t sum x t. And then you can check if this depends or not of x0. You can try to check empirically if the system is ergodic or not. Okay. And then the problem is that, you compute, if this doesn't depend on x0, you are tempted to say this is ergodic. Okay. My ergodic, the mathematician, the word ergodic is ergodic respect to a certain measure, not ergodic. In the Hamiltonian system, it is obvious that the invariant measure is the microcanonical. But in this point, in this problem is that respect to what is this rho? How I determine rho? For example, in this situation, what is the invariant measure of this rho? So at empirical level, before you can give an answer at empirical level, you can consider the following. So you can consider a set of points, x1, xm. Let me put here zero. So you can consider an initial probability distribution. At the practical level, you take 10,000 points in a certain region uniformly, for example. And then numerically, you can look at the evolution of this. You take 100 points uniformly distributed between 0.3 and 0.4. Then you look at the evolution, you perform an histogram. And you can compute numerically stuff. And then you look what happens when t go to infinite, if this go to something or not. This go to some rho invariant. OK? Oh, believe me, this happened. This happened. And you can, OK, this is at empirical level. Now, in a more mathematical way, how I can construct this stuff. So this problem corresponds exactly to the path in statistical mechanics. So in statistical mechanics, you have an Hamiltonian equation, and you write the Liouville equation, right? So the Liouville equation, just to show you, okay, the analogy. So yeah, Hamiltonian equation. The Hamiltonian equation, you have x dot equal f of x. I write in a formal way, okay? Then you have the Liouville equation. This is the Liouville equation, okay? And you know that the Liouville equation, the stationary is microcanonical. And then you can repeat the game here, the game with a map, 1D map. 1D map, you have xt plus 1 is equal f of xt. Okay, now you have to find the analogous of this equation. So the problem is the following. Now the time is discrete. The time is discrete. So the problem is the following. You have the probability distribution at time t, and you need the rule to construct the probability distribution at time t plus 1. So if you find this rule, this is exactly the analogous this. Okay. And okay, if you write this equation, then you have an evolution law, and you can wonder a lot of problem, a lot of question, about this stuff. And this question is exactly the same question. I don't know, you wonder when you study, for example, Markov chain. It's exactly the same problem. Now, more difficult because we are in a functional space, but part of the mathematical dictate conceptually is exactly the same stuff. So, okay, now this is possible. Okay, this is possible. How is possible? For example, let me consider just a simple case, and then the generalization is obvious. Let's consider the tend map, the F. This is F. What is it considered? The tend map. And I want to write the evolution equation for the probability density in the tend map. Now, let me. What about the probability that at x at time t plus one is between a certain x and x plus delta? This is if delta is small enough. This is, let me write in a physical way, it's clear. No? This is just rho t plus one x delta. Okay. So this is x, and this is x plus delta. The probability, this stuff is the probability to stay here. But the probability to stay here, there are only two possibilities that at the previous time, you start from here or from here. You see? So this point here, this point, this is x over two, no, because the slope is two. This point here is, this is one minus x over two. So this, the length of this, let me call delta prime. Delta prime is delta over two because f prime is equal to. You see? So then you have that. This is nothing but the probability that x time t is between x alpha plus delta prime plus the other plus probability x t is between one minus x alpha plus delta prime. Okay. Then, if delta is small, okay, this quantity, what is this quantity? This quantity is just rho time t computed in x alpha time delta prime, but delta prime is delta alpha. On the other side, the same. Okay, so now you simplify delta. You simplify delta, and what you have the evolution law, which is very horrible, but at least it is a linear operator. So you have the equation in the following: rho time t plus one in x is one alpha, rho time t compute in x alpha plus rho time t one minus. Which apparently is really horrible. Actually, sorry. But you have the law. You have the law. Okay. But then, if you follow the reasoning, you understand how to generalize this. Maybe after the stop. Okay. The generalization is the following. I write, then I discuss later. So, if you have a situation like this, the evolution law is the following. Where xk are the so-called pre-images of X, so are the point such that F of X K is equal to X. But just to what I mean, so if F is this one, for example, if X is here, I have only two terms. If you are, I am here, I have four, okay? So this is in a compact way, like before, rho t plus one is equal to a certain operator, rho t. Okay. This is a linear operator, for sure. Rather horrible because it's not local. But this is, at conceptual level, this is analogous of the Liouville equation, which gives you the evolution of the rho. Now you have this this structure, and you can wonder a lot of problem. How behave this at a large time? If there exists an invariant probability distribution, which kind of property there is, and blah, blah, blah. If this is ergodic or not, respect to a certain specific rho. I guess this is the time for the stop. I don't know, do you prefer to do a question now or after at the end?
Questions?
I don't know, sir. I get lost when you from the first equation to the last.
No, I show you this. This is just the result. Okay. The next class, I prove this equation.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Don't worry.
Could you please repeat quickly the process with which you start from x and x plus delta, and then you get to the second step, and how you relate this to the equation you wrote about the probability?
Okay. Do you agree about this? So the probability to stay here at time t plus one is possible in two ways, that the previous time you are here or here, because if you evolve this point, you are right here. If you evolve this point, you are right here. That's it. This was the question? Okay.
Any other questions?
Okay, we stop for 10 minutes.
Yeah, we take a break until 12. Okay. Yes, okay.
Okay, so let me prove this this relation. This operator is called Perron-Frobenius operator, or Frobenius-Perron. And I discussed this in 1D, just for simplicity of the notation, but it's not difficult to repeat the treatment in any dimension, or a map of any dimension. Is an exercise for you to generalize to 3 dimensions. Okay, let me show this formula. Okay. Let's take, something like that, just to. Okay, at this is f, this is x. Or let me assume that x is always between 0 and 1, so it's bounded. Okay, now let me consider this x and this delta, this x plus delta. I repeat the game of before. If I repeat the game of before, let me call this x1, and then we call this X2, the two pre-images, okay? And here, Here I have delta. Here I have a set, let me call this delta one, the size of this. What is this? So I have that delta is f prime of x1, delta one, if delta is small. Do you agree? You see? So I have the delta one is delta over f prime of x1. If I repeat the same game here, I have the same story. Delta two is delta f prime x2. But here you have to put the modulus, no? Because what is important is not important the slope, but is a modulus slope. So let me write in this way. So delta one is delta over f prime computing x1. And the same. Then I repeat exactly the same story of before. And I have that just repeating exactly the same argument before I ever, if delta up to here, in this region, the rule is the following. The rule is, sum from J from one, two, and rho xj, f prime, J in this region. If I consider this region here, this part, I repeat the same story, but now I have 4 points. I have this, 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 and this. So you see, and in this region, the same story with four. So the generic formula is the following, this one. Where k can depend of x. So this region is two, here is four, here is again two. Okay, so the apparently strange, but this is nothing but the conservation of probability. You are saying that in order to stay here, you have to consider all the possibility at the previous time. In this case, there are two, here there are four, and so on. Just to, in order to remind the formula, there is a very simple way to remind the formula. If you remember the simple way, you remind the elementary property of delta. Look at this. It's very simple to remind. And then it's also very intuitive. So the probability to stay in X at time t plus one is given by all the possible combination to stay at time t. Okay, you realize these are trivially equivalent. Okay, and this is a way to remind and that's it. Okay. And so if you repeat this game in more than one dimension, it's not difficult. If you have something like that, x t plus one equal a certain f x t, where x is in R2 or 3, whatever. You repeat the game, and you have something like that. You have that plus one x is equal to all the pre-images. And here, instead of f prime, you have the Jacobian of the transformation. So you have instead of f prime, let me write d of x. Where D is the determinant, where D is the determinant of the matrix A and the element of the matrix are in this one. Okay, it's obvious. The argument is exactly the same. Instead of saying within an interval, you take a volume and so on. So in any dimension you can repeat the recipes. But we consider only the 1D is enough to suffer. Now we have, let me write in a compact way, we have xt plus 1 is equal f of xt, and I have rho t plus 1 is equal a certain operator, rho of t. I write in a compact way, Now, this situation is very similar. No, it's very similar. It's completely parallel to the problem you have in Markov chain. Let me open here a short parenthesis of Markov chain. So in Markov chain, you have Markov chain are much simpler because in Markov chain, you have discrete time. Even here the time discrete, but you have discrete state. You have discrete states, 1, 2, n. Here the state is not discrete, it's continuous. This is the difference. Okay. So now you have that the probability, let me call P of T, the probability to stay in the state 1 or 2 and so on. So you remember that if you know the probability at time t, you have the probability at time t plus 1. And you obtain this using the transition metrics. No? So you have something like that. Okay, this is the translation of the formula P to the probability to stay in P at time T plus 1 is the sum of the probability to stay in J at time T for the probability to jump from J to I. So you see, you have this structure, and this structure formally is very practically is the same, as exactly the same structure of this one. But this situation is much more difficult in mathematical terms, because here you are in a functional space, and there you are in discrete space. Okay, but now you know that the Markov chain, everything is hidden here. Everything is hidden in this transition matrix. So, in P, the probability to jump from two states, looking on this transition matrix, you understand all the possible things that you can wonder about in the Markov chain. So in the Markov chain, for example, you have the idea of invariant. The mathematician use the term invariant, we physicists use stationary, but it's the same. Probability. So you say the P stationary or invariant. So obey to this equation. So stationary means that if you start from there, you remain there. If you start the stationary, this remains there. And you can wonder if this is unique or not, for example. And this depends of the kind. I don't know if you are familiar with the Markov chain, the classification, periodic, aperiodic, blah, blah. So if the system is a periodic, irreducible, then the invariant probability is unique. Okay. And then not only is unique, but also attractive. So it means that in the everybody are familiar with this stuff? Okay, so for good Markov chain, where good means a periodic, reducible, blah, blah. You have that if you start from a certain P0, then you consider the evolution. And then you consider the limit t go to infinite, this approach to the stationary probability distribution. Not only, but you approach also exponentially fast. Okay? You have this stuff. Okay? Now you and in addition, the system is ergodic. In the sense discussed before. So and this is the idea of Monte Carlo. No, in the Monte Carlo, instead to compute the average as an average of the probability distribution, you perform a random walk among the states with a certain rule and blah blah blah. Okay. Now you can it's quite natural to repeat the same problem there. Okay. So now the problem is default. So now the invariant measure, variant distribution. Let me use a more not formal. The invariant distribution is what means it's something like that. Invariant means that if which satisfy this equation. I apply the Perron-Frobenius operator, and this give you the same result. Okay, then you can wonder if the Perron invariant is ergodic. And if rho invariant is attractive. Attractive means I start with a certain rho zero, I compute the evolution, and I look at the limit of this. These are the typical problem you have in the case of the map, of course. Okay, then you can translate also this. I discuss all the map in 1D, but you can translate, you can repeat in 2D, 3D, and if you want, you can repeat in dynamical system. In dynamical system, you have something different, but the concepts are exactly the same problem. Okay. Now, let me just. Show that ergodicity is a nice property, but not enough. Sometimes not enough. So let me just. No. The first day we start smooth. Consider an example, very simple example, which is the rotation on the circle. This is there. Rotation of the circle is the following. You have a circle, and you have x0 and x1 is just x0 plus something. Omega. Okay, since it's a circle, you take modulus 1. Okay. Modulus 1 or modulus 2 pi, but just for simplicity, I can say the circle of a length. Okay, so the rule is the following: xt plus one is equal xt plus omega modulus one. And the question, okay, yeah, try to reply to this problem. So, what is the invariant distribution? Is the invariant distribution is ergodic? Is the invariant distribution is attractive? Okay, this is an exercise. In this case, we can do all the computation explicitly, but I guess it's one of the few cases. It's just an exercise. Okay. Okay. First point: the invariant probability. The invariant probability it just, this is very simple. We just to apply the rule I discussed before, no? Because the F is this way. This F is X. This is the rule. This is omega. This is the rule. No? Okay. So I have to write the evolution equation. Rho T plus one X is equal. So in this case, I have only a pre images. I have only this, I have only this. Okay. So I have only the I have X, the pre images, the X prime is X minus omega modulus one. You see that I have only one and the slope is one. So I have just that rho at time t plus one is nothing but rho at time t compute in X minus omega. Consider on the circle. Okay, and that's it. This is the prof Frobenius equation in this case, which is absolutely trivial, because now if you impose the rho invariant X is equal rho invariant X minus omega, immediately you have the solution is rho invariant equal one. This is the reason why I take modulus one. Okay. This is a constant. This is constant, which sure is invariant. Okay, so the rho invariant is constant. Fine. Then you can wonder if it's ergodic or not. No? This is rho invariant. Rotation on the circle. Now you can wonder if this is ergodic or not. So the answer is that is ergodic is omega is irrational. It's not ergodic is omega is rational. How you can prove this? So you can prove with the brute force computation, explicit computation. It's not exactly a great force, just an explicit computation. So I take an observable. I consider just for, as mathematicians say, for generosity, I assume that H, an observable which is analytic. So it's analytic, so I assume that I can perform a Fourier expansion, Fourier series, S and this N different from zero, is A N, A E, 2 pi N X, okay? Then I take this observable. Of course, if I perform the average according to the invariant X, 0, 1, so, this is one. So the integral of this, this term give you a zero, and the other give zero. Give zero because it is the integral of this. And that's it. So the average on the invariant distribution is only h zero. Now I have to compute the probability the time average, okay? In order to compute the time average, I have to perform the evolution and then the average. So I have to compute this stuff. I have to compute one over t, sum of t from zero to, from one to t, zero to t minus one. Here I have x t. Okay, and so one over t minus one, and I have this stuff, zero plus sum n different from zero, a n, here I two pi nxt. Okay, but xt, what is xt? Xt is x0 plus t omega, modulus 1. No, if I iterate, so I can put here. Here is x0 times 2 pi n omega t. I have this, this stuff. So you see that the fact that modulus 1, since it's here, is free. Okay, so now this is trivial. This term is h0. Now, the second term, we have sum of n different from 0, ai 2 pi n x0. And then I have 1 over t, sum of t from 0 to t minus 1, this stuff. But this is, let me write in this way. I can write it this way. Okay, so you see, I have a sum of something like t from 0 t minus 1 of alpha to t. This is alpha. Okay, so what happened? So there are, if alpha is different from 1, there are two possibilities. Alpha is different from 1 or alpha is equal to 1. Okay. Let's consider the case alpha different from 1. Alpha different from 1 is when omega is irrational. Because in order to have this 1, means that this number must be integer. So if omega is irrational, this is impossible. So you see that in the case, so this is true if omega is irrational. So in this case, just you apply the elementary geometric series. Here you have 1 minus alpha t, 1 minus alpha. Okay, and that's it. So in this case, you have A0 plus sum n, you know, 0, blah, blah, blah. And here you have 1 over t, and you have this quantity. Take the limit t go to infinite, this go to zero. Remain on this. So you see, if omega is irrational, this is ergodic. If omega is not irrational, what it means? It means that omega must be, omega is something like k over m. Okay, if I put here k over m, I have repeat the consideration. So if n is not multiple of m, I repeat again. In all the case where this number is integer, I had to maintain this quantity is 1. Okay, so at the end of the story, I have that what remains is 0 plus the sum on all the n such that n k is m integer and remain this is 1. This is one, remain this one, remain this. Remain a n to pi n x zero. So you see that in the case this is rational, you can perform the average trivially, but the important result is that now this is the time average that exists because of the Birkhoff theorem, but remain is a function of x0. This is the trouble. It's a function of x0, and so this system is not ergodic. But if it's not ergodic, another way to see that it's not ergodic, you have just to note that the system is omega is rational, the system is periodic. This is periodic. Why? If it's rational, the system is quasi periodic. Okay, this means if you plot, if you follow the system on the circle, in the case irrational, at the end you the point you cover uniformly the circle. Why? If it is irrational, you have just a finite number of points. Okay, this is there. So in this case, when you see that you can you have that the system is ergodic. Is ergodic, but okay, is ergodic. Then you can wonder, but fine, is ergodic, but is attractive or not? No, it's not attractive. In fact, it's not attractive. You realize immediately, so I delete the equation. Let me write again the equation for the evolution. The equation of evolution is this one. What is the meaning of this equation? The meaning of this equation is just a rigid translation. So this means that you take you take rho zero, and rho one is just this just shift of omega. That's it. So you, okay, this is zero one. Okay, you start from this is rho zero, this is rho zero. Rho one is simply this shifted by omega. You see from this equation. So if you start with some non uniform distribution, this just remain for the rest of the life, just this move. If this is triangle, remain triangle. If this is a semicircle, remain semicircle. And that's it. So, there is no way that this approach to the invariant, apart the case that you start with the rho invariant. So of course, if rho zero is different from rho invariant, then rho t cannot approach to rho invariant. Because just remain trivially the stuff. So you see that you can have an ergodic ergodic system, but somehow trivial. Okay. Now, this is about the. Okay, now apart the game, I don't know, let me show something less trivial on this. Something on the other thing, you discussed already with Fabio Cecconi the logistic map, no? I guess. And I don't know if Fabio discussed the fact that the logistic map you can perform a change of variable such that you have the 10 map. Do you discuss this stuff? No, okay, but don't worry, it's not. Let me just use this last 10 minutes. Okay, consider the 10th map. 10th map, rho. T plus one F X T, where F is this situation. Okay. And you can wonder what in this case, what is the invariant distribution? So it is uniform, but is a coincidence. It's not true in general. Look in your. In your notes, you have the equation, this one. Okay, this is the evolution equation. And then you see immediately that okay, rho invariant, x is equal to one half rho invariant x half plus rho invariant 1 minus. And you see that you have a solution, not the solution, well, a solution that rho invariant equal 1. You see that it's satisfied. Rho invariant is equal 1 is satisfied. Okay, then you can wonder if this is attractive or not. Yes, it's attractive. There is a proof, but it's not completely trivial. So you can check, for example, numerically. You can check numerically. You start with what is the deep reason that this is attractive? The main reason is the fact that f prime modulus is larger than one. This is which is an effect of instability. So if you, for example, if you start from in a probability distribution here in this part, probability distribution, this shape. So, Okay. So what you have that these remain something like the size, the altitude, is half of the after iteration, the area is conserved, this length decreases of factor two. Why the size increases factor two because of the spreading, and then you of course when you enter in the other regime, it is not easy to follow the argument, but this is the basic argument. You can do numerically. So actually, what you have that if you look at the evolution, this actually go to this go to the invariant, and the deep reason is because you have f prime larger than one. You have f prime larger than one. You try to expand, and of course then you have the system must be bounded, and this repeat you have the folding. Okay, but why this is interesting? So and then you can repeat the game. You can repeat the game, and it's just a stupid exercise. If instead to consider an asymmetric tent, something like that, is always the same. So even in this case, is uniform. Even in this case, it's independent if it's perfectly symmetric or not. And this is interesting because there is the following trick or technique. What is the basic trick in mathematics? To change the variable. To change the variable in such a way, after the decision of variable, the situation is simpler. Okay? So you have to find a smart change of variable. So the Fourier transform is this one. Fourier transform, Fourier series, the idea is that something which is difficult in the original space with the Fourier transform is simple. Okay, the mathematician used a very pompous term, because topological conjugation. But topological conjugation translates a change of variable, invertible change of variable. So the idea is the following. Imagine that you have a system like this. No, not this. Imagine that now we have this one, okay? No, not this is but this, okay? In this case, you can repeat. See, if you can try to write this, it's not impossible. It's an exercise. It's simple. You can write. And then you can try to understand what is the invariant probability, and you have some horrible stuff, and you don't understand nothing. Okay. Now the idea is the following. Imagine that I consider another variable x, which is a function of x, invertible. Okay. In such a way, there is no missing of information. then of course this we evolve in some way. We have like g of x t plus one. So this means that this is f of x t, but x t is g minus one y. I have something g f g minus one. So I have something. Well, h is this one. This one is there is a ruler. Okay, you can. Is invertible. J prime is always different from zero. So I take the this equation, and I have another equation. This is for free. This is free, but now I do this only if it is an advantage. Otherwise, why? Okay. So the idea is that I start with this. This equation is not easy to treat. And if I write here something much simpler, the idea is that then from here, imagine that I write something simpler and I am able to compute the invariant probability of y. Let me put here y. If I am able to do this, then I just simply to remind the elementary property of the change of variable in probability. And then from this, I can come back to the invariant problem. To the invariant probability of the original problem. Okay, so this is the strategy. The strategy is to find a change of variable such that the new system, which is always the same system, is a system observed in different different way, is simple enough in order to compute the invariant probability. And then come back. So in practice, for example, imagine that I am able to find a change variable such that for this equation, I have this. Then I have the invariant probability distribution, then I come back. Okay, this is it. So there is a change of variable, then I'll discuss tomorrow. I discuss tomorrow, and it's possible, for example, using this idea to show that the invariant probability of this stuff, this is an expression which not obvious. I think it's okay. You using this trick. Uses this trick, change the variable in such a way that the new variable is the 10 map, and the fact that 10 map is trivial, then I come back. So you see that the probability distribution is the fact that in this case is constant, it's just a coincidence. In general, it's not constant at all. So yeah, this is a probability distribution which diverges on something like that. Absolutely non-obvious. Not obvious that, well, that is obvious that if you know the trick. So if you know the trick to perform that's it. Okay. I guess we can stop here for the first day. I guess is enough. Question? On the web, somebody asked about the synthetic. You already answered. Up to now, I have no specific hypothesis about which kind of dynamics I have. Now I consider only one dimensional case. I can consider tomorrow, we consider larger dimension. And but it's better to maintain a separate system with a Liouville theorem and system without a Liouville theorem. The conservative and dissipative are completely different. So in the case with the conservative system, Hamiltonian system or symplectic, in this case, the invariant measure is obvious, is the bag measure, is a uniform, okay? all this stuff is absolutely irrelevant. So imagine you realize immediately. In this case, the situation is trivial because since the system is invertible, you have an equation completely trivial. And from there, immediately you realize that the invariant probability is just uniform, and that's it. But this is not true if the system is not conservative. If the system is not conservative in more than the one dimension, we will have a horrible situation. We touch okay, tomorrow or the day after. Because up to now, I discuss about invariant, about density, assuming that density there exists. But this is not true. Absolutely, it's not true. Just for the first selection, just to start in a smooth way. So just considering, I guess Fabio Cecconi introduced you the Enum map. Okay, Enum map, which have a very innocent aspect, is a monster. From the point of view of the measure, is a monster. Monster means that it doesn't exist any density. Not only, but it is also singular respect to fractal geometry. So even an extremely simple system, you can write in two lines on the blackboard, you have an enormous, very rich structure. But we'll see tomorrow. Yes.
Maybe I should watch the video again, but I didn't understand how you go from here and you obtain one, the invariant.
So the invariant is when I assume that the invariant means that at any time, I assume that this is raw invariant and this is raw invariant.
Yes.
Because invariant means that when I perform the evolution, there is no evolution. So I just translate this repeating, writing invariant here, invariant here. That's it.
Now the one, I don't know how you obtain one.
But look, because one is equal 1/2 plus 1/2. So if I assume that this is one, yeah, this is satisfied, you see?
Okay. Okay.
So in fact, I say this is a solution, not the solution. Then you can wonder why you don't consider all the possible solutions. And anticipating this question, how many possible solutions there are? Infinite. So it's better to avoid that solution. So this is a subtle point I discuss tomorrow. This is the, in some sense, I have 20 seconds just to introduce the problem. No, this is a very fascinating problem. I like a lot. Not only me. The people who work in dynamical system, this is the problem is the following. You can wonder, there are other invariant measures? And the answer is yes, there are many. Why? Because this is F. If I consider F2, so just FF, which means the evolution, I have something like that. If I consider F4, no? I have okay, 4 is enough. Okay, then let me consider this point. This, and this. Okay. Why? So this point are fixed point of the map F4. So these are periodic point. So if I immediately I realize that if I consider rho, if I consider the slope of this stuff are the same. So if I consider the sum of normalization, okay, delta x minus this point, xk, this is invariant. This is invariant because you saw the one point moving the other. So this means that if I consider fk many times, and I look at all the stuff which are correspond to unstable periodic orbit, and I consider the measure concentrated to the unstable periodic orbit of any period, all the period you like, this is invariant. That's it, it's invariant, it's a remark, okay? And then you can wonder, why? But this is the problem. So mathematically, this is the problem, because why this and not this? This is horrible, no? So the first wish is just remove, okay? And of course, but you have to be an authorization to remove this stuff. And so you have at least some, no, not say proof, but some argument to remove. Tomorrow I'll tell you that. Okay, so the idea is that this is a solution, not the solution. The problem is that, but in some sense, this is the solution. The solution, because this solution are unphysical. Are unphysical and can be removed with a very physical argument.
Okay, so thank you very much. So we meet again at 4 p.m. here.